you find you can't love anybody? What's the blockage? Are you letting God love you? Or are you so ashamed of what's going on in your life? Do you find you can't forgive anybody? What's the blockage? Because you're not forgiven. He has to do it through me, to me to do it through me.
This is your final boarding call for Israel 2016. Don't miss out on this amazing experience. Reserve your place now for November 17th to the 27th, 2016.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a once-in-a-lifetime exploration of origin and destiny. Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we travel to Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, we'll visit Jerusalem, the Sea of Galilee, the Mount of the Beatitudes, the Dead Sea, as well as other amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hillary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family on a trip of a lifetime. This is your last chance to reserve your spot now. For November 17th to the 27th, 2016. Visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. That's 1-877-465-3442.
Israel, Awaken 2016. It's your time.
So I'm going to take us back to the road to Emmaus. I hope you still got your passage with you. I hope it's being well marked. And if you want a title for this afternoon, it will be When God Moves In. So yesterday in the morning, we asked a question. How is it that Jesus Christ can move from being a stranger in our lives, who seems to just draw alongside us every so often, on our journey through life, to being an intimate friend with whom we have an ongoing, real, authentic, raw relationship? Jesus Christ came to live with us so that he could live in us. And on the road to Emmaus, we meet these two disciples heading away from Jerusalem, if you remember, away from the temple, heading home, thinking their dreams have died. Jesus has died. All they'd hoped for now will never be. It's all over. The daylight is fading. The darkness is closing in. And we might as well just go home. And you might, if you're totally honest, still be in that place. You might be heading home and the darkness that you brought with you is still there because you have not felt you've encountered Jesus. When we leave the couple at the end of the story, they're not on their own. They're not heading home. They're back in Jerusalem. They're back in the body. They're back with the other disciples. They're not walking away from all that they had hoped for. They're actually now waiting at the temple, positioned, expectant that all that he has said will now become real in their lives. And that's possible. It's possible because Jesus is alive. So what's happened to them? When we met them, they were going away from the temple. Now they've gone back to the temple and they're expecting and full of hope. They're not expecting and hopeless. And what's happened is that Jesus Christ himself has lined up their fears and their doubts with the truth of Scripture and the truth about himself. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. It's good to him. It's pleasing to him. It's perfect to him. And maybe you've been way off track. And maybe you've been suspicious of God's will in your life. And maybe his will is not pleasing to you, but it's pleasing to him. It's perfect to him. And the way we get pulled back into his will is through agony in the Garden of Gethsemane, realigning our will to his, surrendering to his. But it's also through the transformation of our minds. D.L. Moody said, I never saw a useful Christian who was not a student of the word. And Jesus transforms these two disciples by taking them into Scripture and meeting them there and then feeding them from there. He feeds them the word, the bread. The obvious answer as to how Jesus moves from being a stranger to being a friend is that he becomes a part of your life. But more than that, he becomes your very life. He moves in. He moves from the outside to the inside. He becomes your closest friend. And he fulfills all the promises that you have waited for himself. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And there is no life beyond. There is no life outside of Christ. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. The key to how this transformation from the outside to the inside, from stranger to friend, is kind of tucked away at the end of this story. So we're going to read from Luke 24. Let's read from verse 30. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and he began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together, and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way, and how Jesus was recognized by them when they broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." And when he said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. And he said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what's written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." And when he led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple, praising God. See, on this opening scene we had yesterday, we looked at yesterday, we met them walking along a road away. Now we find them waiting at the temple. And Charles has beautifully explored in these last two sessions the significance, some of the significance of the temple. And we've learned that the temple is the dwelling place of God. The temple was a physical building, but now it's we are the temple. This is the place where we have intimate fellowship with God. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. This is the place where God is in charge. This is the place where the enemy is under his feet. This is the place that water flows from, deeper and deeper, bringing freshness, fullness of life, fruit. And you had that wonderful time to do the study about the vine and the branches. No root, no fruit. If you are not rooted in Jesus Christ, there will be no fruit in your life. It's that simple. And it's in the temple I want to spend some more time this afternoon. Why do they wait at the temple? And what does the temple mean to them? I'm sure as Jesus took the disciples into scripture again and did another Bible study with them again, I'm sure he joined some of these dots for them. We know, of course, that the children of Israel had been instructed to build the tabernacle in the desert, which would be replaced by the temple when they settled in the land. And in 2 Chronicles 7, 11 to 16, God had given these instructions to Solomon. When Solomon had finished the temple of the Lord and the royal palace and had succeeded in carrying out all he had in mind to do in the temple of the Lord and in his own palace, the Lord appeared to him at night and said, "I have heard your prayer. and I've chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices. When I shut up the heavens so that there's no rain or command locusts to devour the land or send a plague among my people, if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and will heal their land. I don't know where you are in that sentence. Called by name, humble, praying, seeking, turning from your wicked ways. Sometimes people say, God's just not close to me, but God has some conditions and they all need to be walked through. And when they are, God says, verse 15, now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place, in your temple. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there. Don't you know your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? And how you feel about God's eyes and God's heart always being inside you? The Shekinah glory filled the temple, and the temple was the place where provision was made for cleansing, for forgiveness through sacrifice. However, only the high priest, as we know, was allowed into the Holy of Holies, and most people kept their distance from God. The thing that God says to people over and over again as he's introducing Jesus is, fear not, fear not, fear not, because that's our instinct as God comes close. God in Christ was coming to move in. He wasn't just coming to visit the earth anymore. He'd made the world, visited the world, met with people, and now it was time to live in the world and come to stay. Leviticus 26, 11 to 12. I will put my dwelling place among you. I will walk among you and be your God. And now Jesus walks among us and he comes to stay. The word became flesh and dwelt among us, so that by his spirit he could live in us, the incarnational presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what does it look like in my life when God moves in? These two disciples had been present and around with Jesus. And I don't know if you've ever thought about what the temple meant to Jesus and what role it played in the life of Jesus. And where's the first time we see Jesus in the actual physical temple? Well, it's when he's a baby. Luke chapter 2, verse 21 to 40, records what happens when his parents take him there. They take him into the temple with a little offering of pigeons because they can't afford a lamb. The next time we see Jesus in the temple, he's a young boy and his parents have gone to Jerusalem with him. He's 12 years old and they're all caught up in the wonderful celebrations and the Passover, and on their way home they look around and Mary says to Joseph, where's Jesus? And Joseph says, well, I thought you were with him. She says, no, you were with him. Oh dear, neither of us is with him. So they turn around, they go back to Jerusalem and they head back to the temple. Luke 2 verse 46. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts. After 3 days. Can you imagine what that's like? If you lose your child for 5 minutes in the mall, you're frantic. They find him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. When the parents saw him, they were astonished, and his mother said to him, son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you. Why were you searching for me? He asked. Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house? But they didn't understand what he was saying to them. You see this picture? You are the temple. And Jesus was about his father's business in the temple. And he knew his father's business and he knew his father's desire. This was his father's desire. Isaiah 56 verse 7. These I will bring to my holy mountain and give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. I'm the house, you're the house. My house will be called a house of prayer. How will God transform my house and your house into a house of prayer? And now I want to think about Jesus as the adult in the temple. And now it looks very different. Remember when Jesus entered the temple, he actually turned it upside down. And what he's doing is fulfilling Psalm 69, verse 9, "Zeal for your house will consume me." And I don't know if you realize, the Lord Jesus Christ has zeal for his house. That's you and that's me. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So look what happens when Jesus moves into the temple. John chapter 2, verse 12. After this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and his brothers and his disciples, and they stayed there for a few days. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and in the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords, and he drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here! Stop turning my father's house into a market!" His disciples remembered that it's written, "Zeal for your house will consume me," and it still does. See, what's going on here is that it's Passover. Thousands of people have made their way into Jerusalem and headed to the temple to pay tax and to sacrifice. They've come from out of town with money that needs changing. The money changers are charging exorbitant rates to change money. And you, as you know, all over the city of Jerusalem, you get different rates depending on where you are. And the sellers of the oxen and the sheep and the doves for sacrifice are also on the make. So what would cost 9 cents outside in the streets, there'd be a big markup on it. So the people are under pressure to exchange their offering because they turn up with their little lamb and it's looked at, and the sellers say, "That lamb, it's got a spot and a blemish on it. I'll give you a perfect lamb." So now they have to pay money, and then they have to exchange their money to pay the money. And the Gentiles were kept on the periphery. They were not welcome. And in Mark 11, Jesus says, "My house will be called a house of prayer for all nations, and you have made it a den of robbers." You see, if you allow God to move in, if you allow God to fill you with his presence, all of him in all of me, a lot of things are going to get dislodged, disturbed. All the corruption that's going in your life will be exposed because he wants to clean it out. I discovered a very sobering passage in Ezekiel chapter 8, verse 1. We're taken on a tour of the temple, and it's frightening. It exposes the idolatry and the corruption in the temple, and I'm going to read it all to you, and it might actually be very painful for some of you, because this is a tour which takes you into the darkest, dirtiest, most idolatrous parts of your life. Ezekiel chapter 8. "In the sixth year, in the sixth month, on the fifth day, while I was sitting in my house and the elders of Judah were sitting before me, the hand of the sovereign Lord came on me. I looked, and I saw a figure like that of a man. From what appeared to be his waist down, he was like fire. And from there up, his appearance was as bright as glowing metal. He stretched out what looked like a hand, and he took me by the hair of my head. The Spirit lifted me up between earth and heaven, and in visions of God, he took me to Jerusalem, to the entrance of the north gate of the inner court, where the idol that provokes to jealousy stood. And there before me was the glory of the God of Israel, as in the vision I had seen in the plain. Then he said to me, 'Son of man, look towards the north.' So I looked, and in the entrance north of the gate of the altar, I saw this idol of jealousy. And he said to me, 'Son of man, do you see what they are doing?'" If you're ringing things in your Bible, these words, "do you see," and "what you see," come up over and over again in this passage. "Do you see what they are doing? The utterly detestable things the Israelites are doing here, things that will drive me far from my sanctuary. You will see things that are even more detestable." Then he brought me to the entrance to the court, and I looked, and I saw a hole in the wall. And he said to me, "Son of man, now dig into the wall." So I dug into the wall, and I saw a doorway there. And he said to me, go in and see the wicked and detestable things they are doing there. So I went in and looked, and I saw portrayed all over the walls all kinds of crawling things and unclean animals and all the idols of Israel. And in front of them stood 70 elders of Israel. And Jezaniah, son of Safan, was standing amongst them. Each had a censer in his hand, and a fragrant cloud of incense was rising. And he said to me, son of man, have you seen what the elders of Israel are doing in the darkness, each at the shrine of his own idol? They say, the Lord does not see us. The Lord has forsaken the land. And again he said, you will see them doing things that are even more detestable. And then he brought me to the entrance of the north gate of the house of the Lord, and I saw women sitting there, mourning the God of Tammuz. And he said to me, do you see this, son of man? You will see things that are even more detestable than this. And he brought me into the inner court of the house of the Lord, and there at the entrance to the temple between the portico and the altar were about 25 men with their backs towards the temple of the Lord and their faces towards the east, and they were bowing down to the sun in the east. And if you read on, in Ezekiel, you discover God will not tolerate this. He will not share his temple with anyone or anything. And in chapter 9, the idolaters are killed. And in chapter 10, the glory of the Lord leaves the temple. He's promised us, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. But he will not cohabit with idols. He's promised to stay, and part of his role as he stays in our lives is to clean us and to cleanse us. One day Jesus came to Peter and he knelt before him with a bowl of water. And Peter resisted and said, no, you won't wash me. And Jesus said, unless I wash you, you have no part in me. How are you doing putting your feet in the basin with Jesus? When did you last allow him to expose the dirt in your life? Your feet are the dirtiest part of your life in Israel. You know that. They get all dirty. You're walking in the dust. See, this is not about people out there. This is about me and you. This is about my life and my temple and my secret world. In this world we go into, there are women. There are women, idolatrous women. There are men. There are elders. There are priests. In other words, there are pastors involved in this. And the Lord takes Ezekiel deep into this inner place, and he has to go through doors and he has to dig through walls to get to the truth. And what is the truth? The truth is that at the heart of the temple, they are worshipping idols in the darkness. How about you? What's going on in the dark, in the secret place of your life? Maybe you're kidding yourself like they are, that God doesn't see. They said God doesn't see. But God sees, of course God sees. As Hagar said, you are the God who sees. God sees everything. He knows what's going on in the temple. He knows what's going on in your body, bought at a price, with his body, reserved for him, his indwelling, and yet he finds their idols. And an idol is simply anything that takes God's place in your life. It takes your affections. It takes your emotions. It takes your strength. It takes your physical actions. It sucks up your longings. It takes your focus, it takes your energy, it takes your hobby time, it takes your personal time, it takes you further than you ever thought you would go. And you'll know if you have an idol in your life, because you will get angry with anybody who gets in the way of you worshiping your idol. If anybody thwarts your precious time with this idol in your life, the idol will demand more and more and more of your time and affection, and it will seep into your thoughts until it gets a grip of you in the deep, dark place deep within you. I don't know what you long for. I don't know what your idol is. It could be materialistic. It could be the latest fashion. You're constantly shopping, never satisfied. I know women who go and buy clothes just so they can bring them home and try them on, and they have no intention of keeping them. They just take them back again. Longing for cars. What about the secretary at work She's married, but you have got your eye on her. And when you're away from work, she's in your mind. What about images on the computer? You might be living in denial and delusion, thinking that nobody sees and the secret is yours, but you have no secrets from God. No secrets. And the more you become connected to your idol, the further away you will be from the people you love and know. They will have to dig through walls, bury through into these awful places in the temple, all barriers between them and you. And they can't. They can't get in. You've made sure they can't get in. But God gets in. And what does he find? Love for him has been replaced by love for an idol. And it's the elders with their backs towards the temple of the Lord and their faces towards the east who are bowing down. The elders. Do you have a face-to-face relationship with God? When did you last look God in the face? When I used to question my children when they were little, and when I was a teacher and I'd say to a child, did you do that? And they'd look down, shuffle their feet. I'd say, look me in the face. Look me in the face and tell me, did you do that? It's very hard to lie to somebody when you're looking in their eyes. The heart's deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, but God knows what's going on in it. We have a little fridge magnet on our fridge that my son gave me many Mother's Days ago. It said, you can fool some people some of the time, but you can't fool my mum. Well, you can't fool God. And God will not share his sanctuary with any other. That's why he invades our lives, to conquer the enemy within, to expel the enemy, to reign supreme, to draw our hearts back to him, to clean us. And he has to do it to me, to do it through me. Do you find you can't love anybody? What's the blockage? Are you letting God love you? Or are you so ashamed of what's going on in your life? Do you find you can't forgive anybody? What's the blockage? Because you're not forgiven. He has to do it through me, to me, to do it through me. I wonder what sort of a picture you have of the Son of God and how you think he's going to transform you from one degree of glory into another. You see, some of us would love Jesus to be gentle Jesus, meek and mild, look upon this little child. Well, you're not a little child any longer. You're a grown-up adult. And there is a beautiful, gentle side to Jesus. Come to me, take my yoke upon me, learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart. But there's another side to Jesus, and zeal for his house consumes him. He burns in us. This Son of Man has got fire. And fire cleanses, and fire hurts. Dorothy Sayers says, the church has very efficiently paired the claws of the Lion of Judah and certified him as a fitting household pet for pale curates and pious old ladies. He's not a cat, he's not a household pet, he is Aslan, as C.S. Lewis showed us in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. And there's this wonderful description in that book. When one of the children is talking to Mr. and Mrs. Beaver and they ask, is Aslan safe? And Mrs. Beaver says, if there's anyone who can appear before Aslan without their knees knocking, they're either braver than me or just silly. Then isn't he safe? Asked Lucy. Safe? Said Mr. Beaver. Don't you hear what Mrs. Beaver tells you? Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe. But he's good. And he's the king, I tell you. Jesus is not safe. When the Lion of Judah moves in, he moves in to be the owner of the house, and sometimes he's gentle and sometimes he's very strong, but he's always loving, always loving. The love of Christ turns our lives upside down. Unless I wash you, he touches every part of our being, and the fire burns away the dross. I remember when my sister and I were young and we used to play kiss catch in the playground. Sure, none of you ever did that. we did in England, and I like playing kiss catch because I could run faster than most of the boys. So that meant that I only let the boys I wanted to catch me. Otherwise, I just ran away. I didn't want the spotty ones, so I just took off. So one afternoon we were playing, and my sister fell, and it was gravel, and we went in, and the teacher just put up an elastoplast on it. And that night we went home, and my mum said, "You're going to have to show me, Jane," because she could see the elastoplast. "You're going to have to show me the wound." And Jane said, no, it's all right. It's all right. You know, the teacher dealt with it. My mum said, no, you need to show me the wound. So, you know, the quickest way to take a plaster off is just go, it's none of that peeling business. The plaster was off and there was the wound. And Jane said, "But it's all good. You know, she cleaned it." My mum looked at it. She said, "It's full of gravel." Jane said, it'll be fine. She was about eight. My mum said, "It will not be fine. I need to clean it out." And Jane said, "But it's going to hurt." My mum said, "Yes, it's going to hurt, but it's going to hurt a lot more if you leave it all in here and put the plaster on and pretend it's all okay." And that's what it's like in our lives. It hurts. That stuff you've buried in there, it's a wound and it's infected. And the longer you leave it, the more infected it's going to become and the more it's going to seep through your body. It'll poison your blood in the end. It'll kill you. We have to let Jesus take the elastoplast off and dig out the gravel and heal the wound and put his balm, his healing balm on it. So these two disciples start talking to Jesus. He's on the outside. They invite him in. Their hearts burn as the Lion of Judah moves in and as his zeal for their lives consumes him, and they begin to have this fellowship, and he begins to turn their houses into houses of prayer, not as the guest, but the host. He comes in to reign. He comes in at the hardest moment in their lives, when all they'd hoped for is over. And Jesus always comes at the hardest moment. And look what he says when he comes. Verse 36, Luke 24. "Peace be with you." He does not say, "Shame on you. Shame on you for not trusting me. Shame on you for not waiting for me. Shame on you for walking away from the temple downcast." He says, "Peace be with you." But peace is not what immediately happens when Jesus moves into your life. Because then he says, "Why are you troubled?" They're frightened. They're in turmoil. And that's what happens when he first comes. Don't expect a warm, fuzzy feeling. He's going to turn your life upside down. You better get ready if you invite him in. Turmoil eventually leads to peace. "Great peace have those who love your law, your word, and nothing causes them to stumble," we're told in Psalm 119, verse 165. He reminds them who he is by his presence, and he shows them his hands and his feet. And we know what these hands and feet look like. We had this explained to us in John's Gospel, chapter 20, verse 24, when Jesus appeared to the doubting Thomas. I love what Jesus shows to the one who doubts. John 20, verse 24. "Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'We've seen the Lord.' And he said to them, 'Unless I see the nail marks on his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe.' And a week later, his disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and he stood among them and he said, 'Peace be with you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe.' And Thomas said to him, 'My Lord and my God.'" Apart from the fact that Jesus appeared and invited him to do this, Jesus appeared and Thomas realized he knew what he'd said a week ago. And he turned up to address his question because he sees everything. So why does the resurrected body of Christ still have wounds? That was something I grappled with for a long, long time. Why did the resurrected body of Christ not have no wounds? Why were there holes in his hand? And why was there a wound in his side for Thomas to put his hands in? Well, I've come to the conclusion that it's because Jesus wants to show that there is resurrection life beyond the wounding. There is resurrection life beyond the wounding. And the wounds enable other peoples to put their hands in the wounds and be given hope. because beyond the wounds, you have lived. We often think wounds bring death and it's all over, but actually, they do bring death, but then they bring life. They bring life to you and life to others. In the light of the resurrection, there is life beyond the wounding. If I let you put your hand in my wounds, and I actually have done in these last couple of days, and you see my life, you can be encouraged because there is resurrection beyond the wounding. You have wounds like I have. Yours are different. And maybe you haven't realized there's life beyond. And Jesus is reminding them of his journey and inviting them to see that there's life beyond, there's hope beyond. See, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it abides alone. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. And this is the journey, the wounding, the death, which will bring fruit. Death comes before life. The seed dies before it fruits. And they recognize these hands. They recognize these hands that were nailed to the cross. And they recognize the hands that multiplied the bread and fed people. And when he was at the table, he took bread and he gave thanks and he broke it and he began to give it to them. And then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. He breaks the bread small and he shares it. Then he breaks the fish small and he shares it. And this is the one who took fish and bread, hungry people fed, who turned water into wine. This is the Jesus they know. They saw it on the hillside. They saw it on the beach at the fire when they came paddling through the water and he cooked the fish for them. We recognize him in the breaking of bread and the feeding of others, nourishing and sustaining. And there's something much more profound happening here than just bread being broken and them being nourished physically. Henry Nouwen has probably taught me and centered me in my life more than any other writer. And a few years ago, I stumbled upon his outline of these verses. Jesus took the bread, blessed the bread, broke the bread, and gave the bread. And Henry says, this is simply a reenactment of the life of Jesus Christ. Jesus was taken, blessed, broken, and given. Let me read to you what Henry says. To be taken, to be blessed, to be broken, and to be given is the summary of the life of Jesus, who was taken, chosen by God, blessed by God, broken on the cross, and given to the world. It's also the summary of our life, because just as Jesus, we are the beloved. And one of the greatest things I've learned from Henry Nouwen is that I am God's beloved. Sometimes people say to me, don't you care what people think about you? And I say, no, I don't, because I know who I am in Christ. And I am God's beloved. And if you don't like it, it doesn't matter. I'm not dependent on your opinion, I'm dependent on his, and it frees me to not care what you think about me. All I care is about what God thinks about me. And I am God's beloved, and you are God's beloved. When Jesus stepped into those baptism waters and was about to go into his ministry, he'd been obscurely hidden away. He, in the world's eyes, had done nothing, and God said, this is my beloved son, with him I'm well pleased. And as Jesus went into that wilderness and Satan tempted him, he refused to be given any identity other than his belovedness. I know who I am in Christ. You can tempt me with this, you can tempt me with that, and I don't need it because I am God's beloved. First we are taken, Henry says. Perhaps a better word would be chosen. We are chosen by God. That means we are seen by God in our preciousness, in our individuality. We are seen as precious in God's eyes. The life of the beloved starts by trusting that we are chosen in our uniqueness. We are unique in God's eyes. The second aspect of the quality of life of the beloved is that we are blessed. It's so important that you and I experience that we are blessed. The word benediction means blessing. Literally, bene means good and diction means saying. To bless someone means to say good things about them, good things to them. Do you let God do that to you? I think it's very important that when we touch with our blessedness, we can then bless other people. See, he does it to me and then he does it through me. God blesses me and I can bless people. People need our blessing. People need to know that their father and mother and brothers and sisters bless them. And then we are broken. We are broken people. You and I know that we are broken. A lot of our brokenness has to do with relationships. If you ask me what it is that makes me suffer, it's always because someone couldn't hold on to us or someone hurt us. I know each of us can point to a brokenness in our relationships with our husband, our wife, our father, our mother, our children, our friends, our lovers. But when there is love, there is also pain. And wherever there are people who really care for us, there is also the pain of sometimes not being cared for enough. And that's enormous. What do we do with our brokenness? As the beloved of God, we have to dare to embrace it, to befriend our own brokenness and not to say, that should not be my life. Let's just get away from it. Let's get back on track, as we saw those two disciples doing on the road to Emmaus, trying to put it behind them and move on. No, Henry says, we should dare to embrace our brokenness, to befriend it and to really look at it and say, yes, I am hurting. Yes, I am wounded. Yes, it is painful. I don't have to be afraid. I can look at my pain because in a very mysterious way, our wounds are often a window on the reality of our lives. If we dare to embrace them, we can put them under the blessing. And that is the great challenge. If we live our life as people who are taken, blessed, broken, then we can give ourselves. We are taken, blessed, and broken to be given. I want to tell you something that may sound a little strange, but I really believe deeply that our greatest human desire is to give ourselves. Quite often we say that we want to have a lot for ourselves, then we give a little bit. No, I think the greatest desire, the greatest fulfillment of our heart is in the giving. To give ourselves. It's the letting go. The mystery is that as we let go for others, our lives start bearing fruit. That is the great mystery. Jesus says, it's good for you that I die, because when I die, I can give you my spirit and you will bear much fruit in your life. I really believe that's the final call, to give ourselves. When we are people who are chosen by God, blessed, broken, we can give ourselves to others. Our lives can bear immense fruit. Jesus was chosen by the Father, blessed by the Father. This is my beloved Son, broken on the cross and given. His blood was poured out, and the life is in the blood. As they watched Jesus breaking the bread, breaking the fish, showing him his hands, they're reminded not just of what he did, but who he was. And he was about to show them, this is not just my life, me living in you. This is your life. You want to follow me? This is where I'm going. Taken, blessed, broken, given. That's the journey that you're invited to go on. He took them, verse 50. He blessed them. Remember, we saw them yesterday with broken hearts, blind hearts, burning hearts, believing hearts. Now they have blessed hearts. And he broke them, reminding them through his crucified hands that death lay ahead for them. And they would all die. It would seem nearly all of them were martyred. John 12:23. Jesus replied, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Jesus is the grain, the kernel of wheat, the bread of life, born in Bethlehem. The house of bread, Bethlehem means. The kernel of wheat buried into the ground, crushed. Wheat has to become crushed to become flour, to become bread. I don't know if you've ever thought about that, to feed a hungry world. The disciples are grains of wheat. We are disciples. If we surrender to fall into the ground, to die, to be crushed, to be broken, to be given, blessed to be a blessing, to bear much fruit. See, the last part of the story for these disciples hasn't yet happened. It has for us. They're waiting at the temple for the fulfillment of the promise of the coming Holy Spirit, who would now live in them, pour through them, and be given to the world. Because they invited him into their house, their temple, turning the houses upside down, turning the houses into a house of prayer for all nations. So now they wait at the temple. They don't go back home. They're never going to go back to life as it was. They wait at the temple. It's not over. It's only just beginning, the real adventure. And they can stay because he's come to stay. You've just studied, remain in me and I will remain in you. Abide in me and I will abide in you. Has Jesus really come to stay in your life? Has he come to take up residence? To clean it all out? Or are you avoiding him? Have you actually turned your back on him? Did you dare to make eye contact with him when we gave you those three precious solitary hours to be alone with him? I hope you're not heading back to your obscure little town with all the disappointments that you brought here with you. I hope you will allow Jesus to move from being a stranger to being a friend. An indwelling, permanent resident. The Christ within the life of you, Mary, Sam, Marcus, whoever you are. Are you chosen, broken, blessed, given? It's very easy to line up and have a historical confidence and say, yes, Jesus lived. Josephus told us that, even if we don't believe the Bible. Yes, there's evidence that proves the resurrection. But it's not about historical explanations. It's about personal experience, which is post-Pentecost. It's the Holy Spirit coming and moving into the temple courts.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel.
Join Charles Price next week for more of the Holy Land series, right here on Living Truth.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
Oh.